mostly Dr. Shed, like my advisor, and Dr. Prasad. Everybody knows them, so I need more introduction. They will be able to hear me.
But you cannot hear their questions. She cannot hear their questions.
That will be when the questions come back. Okay.
But how do we know? Dr. Olivier Bodenreiter is from National Library of Medicine, where I did two of my internships over there, and most of my dissertation research was motivated from that time. And the last one is Dr. Kemapo Anyanwu from North Carolina State University. So these are the four members in my committee, and my proposal for dissertation is about a formal graph model for representing, querying, and reasoning on semantic web data. So I believe that many of us have heard of like RDF graph or semantic graph or knowledge graph, like basically like anything related to semantic web and a graph, right? But it was very surprised to me that in this RDF specification, there is no formal definition or formal model for the graph. So basically, when we are using the graph here, it's all about the graph-like nature of the data. And the RDF dataset is formally defined as just a set of RDF triples. And each triples is subject, predicate, and object. So in order to, like, the purpose of my dissertation is to consolidate this RDF model. And let's start with the first, motivating example. Here we have that, we have the knowledge that Bill Clinton holds the political position as the president of the USA. And the time of that, the time span is from 1993 to 2001. And then he succeeded by George Bush. And then this knowledge we extracted from the wiki page of Bill Clinton on like some sample date, 2009 something. So the focus of this dissertation is not on the extraction of the relation or entities. The focus of this is on the representing and querying and then reasoning on the top of semantic web data. So given that, that means that prior to this work, we assume that all part of extraction should be done beforehand. So the two main contributions of my proposal or dissertation is going to be on the two major problems on the semantic web. The first one is, how do we represent the statements about a statement or more complex knowledge, more complex than the binary relationship? So in RDF, you can represent the binary relationship easily, right? You can create, you can describe any resource with a subject, predicate, and object, so simple. But how about when we need to represent the, you need to provide the provenance or the temporal or the certain or the judgment of that knowledge or of that fact or triples. So in that case, I will address that problem is the first contribution. And then the second major questions that we are asking here is, how do we represent the RDF triples in the form of graph? I mean, like a formal graph. So let's start with the first one. The first questions is about this. So you have a fact. For example, you have the fact that Bill Clinton holds the position as the U.S. president from 1993 to 2001. So that is the first, and the second one is like. He's also the governor of Arkansas from 1979 to 1981. So if you represent the fact, it is a simple subject, predicate, and object. But now, given that you need to represent the terms or the date he start and end the job. So generally, if you have the information like metadata about the triples, in general, you will be able to answer a lot of questions. For example, the meta query is related to the provenance, like where is the fact from, or when was it created, or who created that one, or the temporal or spatial information. So in this, we will address like what are the existing approach, and what I would like to propose in the dissertation. So generally, we can classify all the existing approaches in this problem into three main categories. The first one is like the group of approaches that represent in the form of triples. The second is in the form of quadruple, and then the third one is in the form of quintuple. So basically, they will use like three. They will use subject, predicate, and object to represent the fact. Or the second categories, they will add one more column, and the third category they will add two more columns. So three, four, five components in the for the triples. So given this example that the standard reification approach, what it does is it will reify the statement by using the four triples, saying that a statement one is a type of statement and it has subject, predicate, and object. After that, it will annotate the metadata about this fact through this statement instance. The advantage of this is like it is very intuitive and easy to understand. However, because of the cost, so it will take three or four triples to reify just one. So imagine that you have 1 million of triples and you will need like 3 or 4 million of triples to reify just for reification and not annotation at all. So that cost is very very much. And a major issue with this approach is it doesn't have formal semantics. The semantic is undefined, so like we cannot share. Because of this reason, it is discouraged in the LRD.
My first statement is, what do you mean is discouraged in LRD? I thought
yes.
People use.
No, they don't use. Because if they use the blank node like locally, it cannot be shared with other people, with like other applications. So because they don't have the semantics, like nobody can interpret what it means.
So what do they use?
It is a bottleneck. Like some people use reification, but you know, like just publish the data for the consumer aspect. There's no like there's not much. Like they didn't report the use of their dataset. So what we want to propose is instead of reify the statement of the RDF type statement, we create one property instance. Like here, we create one instance, home post 1 is a single property of home post. And this single property will represent the statement. And we use this property to assert the relationship that Bill Clinton. I didn't check that. Bill Clinton is the president, and it has start and ending date. So that is how we propose our approach. The second approach is in the form of triples is paste, and within this, there are three flavors. This approach was proposed by Satya and Dr. Bernard Rader. So in this approach, it has three flavors, C1, C2, and C3. For each context, this approach will create one, two, or three instances of the subject, or subject predicate, subject object, or subject predicate and object. So by that, they will use these instances to assert the relationship. So for example, here we have this is for C2, and they created two instances of Bill Clinton and U.S. President of the RDF type, and then they use this instance to assert the relationship between these two. After that, they attach the metadata to the subject. So that is the paste approach. The advantage of this, they claim in the paper that they save like 50% of the number of triples compared to the standard replication. The disadvantage of this is it is not very intuitive and or understand easy to understand. And it has limited expressiveness because all of the metadata is attached to the either the subject. So for the same example that we have here, like we will provide the same approach that we create one instance of the home host one that is our approach. We will go, this is just the overview, we will go through this more detail later on. The second category of existing approach is called SPARQL. So basically, according to this approach proposed by in 2005, like 10 years ago, we create, so we have subject, predicate, and object. So if we want to talk about this triple, we add one more column called name graph, the fourth column, and you can put like provenance, access control, or whatever information into this one. And the name graph can play the role of the key in this case. The advantage of this is a lot that it is very intuitive. I just add one more column, and you can add metadata to a set of triples instead of just individual triples. The third one is it is standard. It is supported by SPARQL. Even though in the RDF formal semantics, it is not described there, but it is supported by SPARQL. The disadvantage of that is originally it was created for representing the provenance, and then people pick it up for representing like all kind of metadata, like maybe like access control. There are a couple of people on this. So because of that, in the fourth column, you just represent a value, and you do not specify like what does it mean. Is it for provenance? Is it for the source or the access control permission? So because of that, it caused the ambiguous semantics when you interpret among the applications. And this is the for the same example. This is what we propose. We create same thing. We create web-server property. And then we assert the relationship, and then we annotate the metadata. So that is the second category. And the third category of this is in the form of quintuples. So basically, this is for RDF plus approach. What it does is it will internally create one statement ID and associate that with a statement. So with that internal ID, it will be able to add the meta property and meta value into this. So just move back a little bit that in the QAD approach, we have the value, but we do not know what it means, right? In this approach, they say that how about we just add one more column, say we add the properties, and from there we just say like maybe like head source and then the value. This approach is not standard in the way that it doesn't represent the knowledge in the form of RDF triples. It used RDF plus, and because of that, it will need the mapping from the RDF to the RDF plus and vice versa. Another disadvantage of this is it is not compatible with the SPARQL. So that means you need to explain the semantic and the syntax and the semantic of SPARQL in order to support this one. So I have gone over the three categories of existing approaches, and what we are going to do here is we want to develop a mechanism that can allow us to make statement about RDF statement easily. So that approach, it should be intuitive and easy to understand. So this is quite subjective, so I'm just it's up to you guys to think. And the second one is we should be able to provide the formal semantics. It should be well-defined so that multiple applications can create and share the semantics. The third criteria is the scalability. It should be able to scale up to billions of datasets in the LLD. The next one is it should be compatible with the existing standard. I think this is very important because a lot of RDF dataset has been produced, and if we can make the new approach compatible with RDF and SPARQL, we can make use of them, and we don't need to make more effort on working on the compatibility. The last one, I don't think this is the last one, but these are just the thing that I can think of. It should support many kind of metadata like temporal, spatial, or version, access control, provenance, all kind of information you can think of. So when we go through all of these approaches, you will see that the basic idea of this is we need to have the key for the statement so that we can use that for annotation. So instead of adding one more or two more components into the tuples, let's look at that from another perspective. Can we just use a tuple and represent it? We don't need to add anything. So by that, it will be compatible with RDF, OWL, SPARQL, all of the standard. So when you look at from that perspective, you see that if we just use the subject and the object, it cannot be the key. So the only thing left is the property. So if you look at the property first, let's say home policy is the property. And the extension of this property is a set of entity pairs. Say if we have Bill Clinton holds position US president, and then he also holds Arkansas governor, in that case, the extension of this property is the set of subject and object. If you make any assertion into this generic property, it will be applicable for all the pairs in its extension. So that's not what we want. So how about this? So given that we have the extension of this is a set of pairs. So what if we create multiple property instances and we map them one by one to each pair of the entities in the extension? If you do that, you would be able to make any assertion about individual pair by using this property. So from this perspective, you can see that the property instance, it can play the role of the key for the statement ID. And by that, we can say that single property is the instance of generic property. So that is the intuitive approach. We need to formally define it in terms of model-theoretic semantics. So that means how do we, given any set of tuples, they're not RDF tuples. In order to interpret them as RDF tuples, you need to, all of these conditions in the interpretation should be satisfied. Here we have the set of resource, IR set of resources, IP of the set of properties, and in this case, I made it as a generic property to make it different from the single property. For each property, we have one extension that assigned one generic property with a set of entity pairs. So that would make it as a set of entity pairs. So this one, extension from each IP, it will map one generic property to a set of pairs. And these are some extra function. So in order to support the single property, we add a new IPS as a set of a single property, and we also add one more extension function that map single property to a single pair of entities. So this is one. So you can see the difference between the single property. This is a mapping and the mapping from a generic property. So one is a single property is mapped to a single pair, and the generic property is mapped to a set of pairs. So clear, right? And in the RDF interpretation, we add additional criteria in order to define the single property. So there are two ways to define a single property. One is through the RDF type, saying that it is an instance of a single property class. The other way is if you make the assertion that saying that the single property is connected to a generic property from RDF single property of, so that is how we define it. And this is one example that this is just the vocabulary, and we cannot say that it is RDF tuples until they satisfy this interpretation. So the first thing is we will map all of the RDF terms in the vocabulary into the set of resources within the model. And then in this RDF interpretation, we have the set of resources, the set of IP, literal value, and then this is the extension for the generic property, and this is the set of single property and the extension function of single property. So that is how we define the, I didn't give the detail in this slide because it's not readable. So in order to query the if like, let's look at the Singleton graph pattern. So basically there are three steps in order to do this. The first thing that you need to create one instance of the Singleton property. From the RDF Singleton property of, I didn't put enough because not enough space. And then you use that Singleton property to assert the relationship between the subject and the object. And the third one is to annotate this Singleton property with any like property, like key value pair properties. There are two types of queries that you can query, and these two the graph pattern of the queries are based on the Singleton graph patterns. I implemented and evaluated this Singleton property on two datasets. One is YAGO2S and the other one is the BKR. So this is one example of the how the knowledge is represented in the YAGO2S. You see that the fact ID number 1, 2, 3, actually they use a UUID. I just simplify it here. So in this fact ID number 1 and the subject Greg's full day performed the closing of the winterland, whatever. And in this representation, there is no relationship between the fact ID and the triples. So we fix that problem by transforming this fact ID a Singleton property. This is gonna be the Singleton property, and it is gonna be Singleton property of perform. And then we assert a relationship, and that's how we make it compliant with the RDF triples. In the experiment with the BKR, Satya's work, he implemented four approach: reification phase 1, C1, C2, and C3. I added one more, the SP, the Singleton property. And this is the statistic of the size of the dataset. So given this, you see that the reification, it is very noticeable that it's the most expensive. Because for each triple to be reified, it would take like four triples. So it is very obvious. The rest is okay, not much different. So I ran the set of queries that Satya created in his evaluation, and we ran it with two set of queries. One is with a random value and the other one with a fixed value. And we reported the average of the last five runs. So the top two are from Satya's queries, and I added one more evaluation. In that, I want to vary the length of the queries, see like how it would affect the performance, and you will see a lot of difference here. From here, you see that the Singleton property, this line, for the queries, for the same query, we created five set of queries according to the approaches, and if you use a Singleton property, the queries are much shorter than like the other one. And if you look at the performance, you will see that like the for C1, C2, and C3, when we have like up to like 25 patterns in the query, actually it's very long. Because of that, it would take like a lot of time, and like some of them, it didn't even finish, like queue them like after 3 or 4 days. We can explain for this is like because usually, in our queries, the number of patterns is shorter. So I just finished the addressing the first problem. How do we represent a statement about a statement? So I will leave these questions for you, like to have your judgment about the five criteria that we should have, whether this approach meets this or not. So. Back to the motivating example in the beginning, that we have this knowledge, and using this approach, we can represent them in the form of triples. So I made it in two columns. The first one, the first three columns on the left is for the upper one, and the one on the right are for the lower one. So for each of these, we create one single property, and like we simply add the provenance into this one. So we finished the first problem, and the next one is, so let's say this is the knowledge that can be represented in the form of triples. So the next one is, how do we represent this set of triples or any given set of triples in the form of a graph? So this will lead to the second problem. Let's look at this example. I extracted this example, make it smaller for easier demonstration. In the literature, if you look at the RDF specification, you see this node label arc, node diagram. So in this, what it does is, in order to create a graph, you map the subject and the object with the node. In here, we have the view president is the subject and US president is the object. How about the predicate? The predicate are mapped to the label arc, this one. So by keep doing that, this is how the graph will look like. If you look at this from from step by step, so subject, predicate, subject and object are node, and then the predicate is mapped to label arc. So if you look at this, you will see at least two problems here. The first one is the same RDF terms, home host one, is mapped to two different objects. And there is no mapping function can do this job if you need to develop a formalism for this approach. So that is one problem. The second one is we know that Bill Clinton is succeeded by George Bush as the president, right? However, if you want to find a path from Bill Clinton to George Bush, you would not be able to find it in this diagram. So what we are proposing here is change it a little bit. So we also map the subject and the object to nodes. And instead of mapping the predicate to the label arc, I map it into the node 2. So now we have three nodes. In order to make it as a triple, first, we add the initial edge from the subject to the predicate. And second, we add the terminal edge from the predicate to the object and make the label. So that is how we can, similarly, this is how the graph look like. And in the later slide, I will explain to you how the formalism for this formal semantics can be developed. And from here, intuitively, you can see that in order to find a path from Bill Clinton to George Bush, you go from here to Homos 1, and then successor, and then George Bush. So this is the example that we have, and let's say for six triples, we gradually add them in the same systematic approach. So we will map all the subject, predicate, object to the nodes, and then for each triples, we created two initial and terminal edges and connect them. So that's how we generate this graph. Let's see if I can. I spent a lot of time on it. So in the graph, you will see that why do we need this number? Here we have a lot of EI5, ET5. So let me explain it here. That let's say if you have the triple saying home post 1, his successor George Bush, in the same way you also have the home post 2, his successor Frank White. So in that case, if somebody say what is the triple here, right? In that case, it will become ambiguous. Home post 1, his successor Frank White. Somebody may interpret it in that way. But in order to prevent the wrong interpretation, we add labels into the edges. And we use this subscription as the, you can see that is some kind of ID that distinguishes the triples from the rest within the one data set. And here we say that for the first triple, home post 1, EI3, so that means this is the initial edge of triple 3. And this is the terminal edge of the triple 3. So in the same will be applied before. The same interpretation will be applied to the second triples. I will explain the semantics of that one. How do we come up with that later on? So in order to formalize the RDF graph, basically it is very simple. It just for the formalism, it look intimidating, but it is very simple, right, Dr. Shen? You went through that once? So in this, so intuitively you can say that you have a set of RDF tuples and you have the graph, right? The forward transformation is like you will transform the set of tuples into the form of the graph that I just described before that. And the second proposition is, given the graph, transform it into the set of tuples. So basically the transformation back and forth between the two representations. So
are your nodes typed? Are your nodes typed?
No.
I mean, are they different kinds of nodes or all nodes?
All of them are the same. Yes. It is just like they will participate in different functions, mapping functions, but all of them would. So let's say here, right?
So a legal part does have to have an alternating sequence?
No. Yeah. So like here, let's say we'll just be the set of terms and we'll say N is the set of nodes and E is the set of edges, and we map all of the term in the vocabulary into the node in V in N, and then for every tuples we will map the subject, predicate, and object into like three different nodes, and then we have the function that map every edge into a pair of nodes, and then we have another function to map like one initial edge into the terminal edge. So that is how we map it into the graph RDM. I call it as RDM triple node graph.
Are they disjoint, the subject, predicate, object nodes? Are they disjoint or they can be mapped to the same nodes, like subject, predicate, object? Are they disjoint?
You have subject, predicate, and object?
You have functions to map
to
subject, predicate, object to some nodes in the graph, right?
Mm-hmm.
So are they disjoint? Like the mapping, is it disjoint?
Yes.
Okay.
So the second is the proposition two, like backward transformation.
I want to look into the typing issue, though.
Yeah, actually, I haven't read her paper carefully yet.
No, I think it might be an opportunity to more like best practices kind of stuff that will come out of that. Because right now it may be correct and fine, but organizing this thing, you know, is maybe
so
there.
So this is this graph model is generic in the way that it will work with like any given RDF dataset. So if you want to have tighter semantic, you may want to provide another layer on top of that.
Yeah, anyway, the thought that crossed my mind was for the reverse mapping. And I think I'll follow up later. I don't want to interrupt it.
And in the same way that we transform it back into the graph. So when we define a graph, one important operator is traversing the graph, right? So in that case, I define the two concepts. One is the triple path, and the other one is the resource path. So the triple path, you can imagine it as just like a sequence of triples, right? And usually in the model that is described in the RDF specification, usually you explore the nodes, right? You don't explore the predicate. You don't explore the edge, the label edge. So because of that, in the inline diagram, you explore from the subject to the object, object to the other object. You miss, you will skip the predicate. So that's the whole point of coming up with a new model. That in this case, given that we have Bill Clinton, Holmes one, and Holmes one his successor to George Bush. So in that case, because we need to, so if we traverse from Bill Clinton and then explore only the U.S. president, you will miss this path. Holmes one his successor, George Bush. And given that in the RDF model, it is very flexible in the way that you can make any assertion about like basically anything that you can give it a name, right? So if we follow this one, just the formalism of that path. So let look, if you look at this, you see that this is the path that the T1 and T3, you see that from Bifrington, you exploit the host plus one and then the US president. So in this triple path, when we see Bifrington, we get the predicate and we get the object. And we will explore both. If we explore the predicate, we will see the George Bush here at the end of the triple three. So this is one triple, this is another triple.
Right.
Second, the resource path. The resource path, intuitively, it is just like a sequence of nodes, or just like it's a regular path, right? But we need to make sure that the RDF semantics is validated here. So given that we have, so a resource path, basically a sequence of path, where I put the two conditions here. Every two adjacent nodes, they must be connected by an edge. Can be initial or terminal, but it must be an edge. And every three nodes connected by a pair of initial and terminal edges should form a triple. This will avoid the case where initial edge from one triple will form, and the terminal edge from different triples form the same triple, so that is invalid. So this is one example of the resource path, like the path that I explained before, that we want to find a path between Bill Clinton to George Bush. So this is the path. This is interesting example from the YAGO2S SP dataset. So from here, I wanted to find a path between Andrew Carr to Jacob Lu. So I ran my algorithm on this, and this is the path, and this is how it looked like. So if you start from Andrew Carr, and if you follow this line, you will get the resource path of landline 15 that connect Andrew Carr to Jacob Lu. I'm not sure that is very right. And that is the resource path, and the triple path is gonna be, this is the first triple, the second triple, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. So basically that is the resource path, but the triple path will include on the triple that it came across. So that is one intuitive example on the real world, how it looked like in the YAGO2S dataset. Okay, model-theoretic semantics again. So in this, what I will provide here is the three levels of interpretations. So given any vocabulary V, so in the previous model-theoretic semantics, it was not based on the graph. So now I will add the graph model that I described before into this one and make it as the underlying graph model for the model-theoretic semantics. So we have, I am a set of nodes, I use a set of directed edges, and I also add a set of distinct labels to be assigned to the edges. So this is the set that include all of the EI1, EIET1 also. And then a mapping function that map the labels into the set of edges. So this is the main function that we use here. I is the function that map one edge to one other pair of nodes. And IT is the function that map one edge, initial edge to the terminal edge. And these are like some extra function that we use. So let I be the interpretation function that map like all the URI from me into the set of nodes I am here. So in that case, we say that SPO is the gram triples if and only if it satisfies this condition that there must be an edge that connect the subject and the object, the predicate, and there's another edge connect the predicate to the object. And then one more condition, that is there must be a function that map the initial edge into the terminal edge. So in that case, it should map E1 to E2. So in order to support the singular property. In this model, I add the IPS as the set of singular property node, and the N1 extension function to map the each singular property with a pair of nodes. And here I'm just I just represent the condition in the in another form, say in a graph form, say that PSO is a gram triple if it has this condition applied. So that is how we define it, how we use the graph function, the graph model to describe the functions. In the RDF interpretation, we say that the in the very similar to the previous model theoretic semantics, we say that if P is connected to added type and added type connected to added property, so that means P is added type is an instance of the property, and there's a mapping that map initial edge to the terminal edge. So basically, it says that P added type added property is a triple. So you say a general property is an instance of the property class. And in the same way that we define the singular properties here, it is a singular property. It basically you can find a triple saying that it is connected to the RDF singular property class from added type. That's all. And in another way to define a singular property is say is if you can find a triple that connect the singular property and the generic property from the RDF singular property of, so it is just like a new representation. And if a property is a singular property, then it can be only mapped to one pair of subject and object. And the last level of interpretation is the RDFS. So in the RDFS, basically we need to define the class extension, the RDF domain, RDFS domains, RDFS range, sub-property of and sub-class of. So this is the class extension. So basically, this function is from the class extension of C if you can find all the instances that have triples asserted as RDF type C. And second, we say that the if you can find the triples that say X has RDFS domain, Y, and U, U is the subject, X is the predicate, and V is the object. So X RDFS domain Y, and the second triple is U X V. So in that case, U must be an instance of type X. So if you say it in the natural language, then say like if one class is the domain of a property, then the class extension will include all the subject of the same triples. And the same rule apply for the subproperty of and subclass of. In the implementation, I implemented the Dijkstra algorithm. So this is the basic one, and like we did not optimize anything. So we did not estimate a path or a sharp-based path. So naive Dijkstra algorithm. So this is different from this is for our model. This is different from the inline model in that we explore the predicate. So because of that, it will take more time. So in the evaluation, we implemented.
So what's the purpose for implementing this?
So we want to demonstrate that the formal model can be adopted by existing system, and we want to measure like how it would perform in the real system. That's what we get.
So using a particular query operator that you're implementing using this shortcut.
We implement two queries. Reachability queries and sharp-based path query. So we developed two engine called, the first one I developed and I named it as a GraphK, and that is developed on top of WBDD. And the second one is implemented by Jyoti Lika. She's a student from IIT Delhi in India. We use
triple IT Delhi.
Oh yeah, IIIT. We use the YAGO2S dataset that I created with the Singleton Property. It has 267 million of pupils. It is a big graph actually. And within this dataset, I extracted three politician groups like White House, Chief of Staff, and Secretary of State, and Speaker of the White House. And in that, for each input group, I will generate a set of all the possibility of input, and I use that for the reachability queries. So, the first column is the group politician group, and this pairs means like all of the pairs within the total number of pairs, input pairs within this individual group. And the next three columns are for our model. And the last three columns for the inline model, which we are supposed to compare with. So from our model, we say that R means like the number of reachable pairs. We see that like in our model, in each R group, we find 579 out of 2,500 pairs, and 94 for SS and 164 for CS. So basically, in the total of 4,000 pairs, input pairs, we find around 800 reachable input pairs. And TS is the total time it takes for the entire group to run, and in average, it would take around 6 seconds. Per input. If you look at the NLAN, you will see that it is not able to find like any reachable path. It is just because like if you follow to that, if you just explore the object, you will miss the predicate. So that is why it is not able to find like any path in this experiment. And because of that, it's faster. It's only 2 seconds compared to 6 seconds in our model. And total time taken for the shortest path query, so basically 800 input pairs that we found reachable from our model, we fed it into this shortest path query, basically that's our algorithm. And this is the number of reachable pairs. And I ran the algorithm on my engine with one thread and five threads, and I see the improvement around like 30% improve in five threads compared to one thread. So basically, in one thread it would take like 4.5 seconds, and in the five thread, in average, it takes 3 seconds. I didn't run it in other numbers and see how it performed, but that's okay number. And we also ran it with the RDF Primer and with the one thread, and we found that in average it takes 61 seconds per input. So for the shortest path query,
so they're all on the same machine.
Yes, on the same machine. And for this reachability queries and shortest path query, this number I reported for the entire input group. So I was interested in like for a certain shortest distance, like how long does it take? So this is the numbers. So one thing that I noticed from this experiment is the path is really long, the shortest path. So in this case, the shortest path is 54. The longest shortest path is 54 and 138 and 139. Given that, I ran it with the graph K. I think I ran it two times and then three times, and I got the average. So, and for each distance, for each shortest distance, I also got the average of that. So this is basically for graph K, it will take up to 10 seconds for all three dataset, and for adding prefix, it takes around like 30 seconds to 60 seconds for the longest one. So So back to the example, we have motivating example, and this is how we represent it in the Singleton property. And then this is the graph, how it looks like from this example. Right. So that is how I address the two major problems as a contribution in my dissertation proposal. And out of this, I'm still working on it toward my dissertation. The Singleton property approach, we published it at 2014.
It's 11 o'clock.
And the second, the RDF graph model, we submitted in November, and now it is under review. So these two address the foundational problems in the semantic web, and by adopting this model, we are able to develop novel applications. One in our project, we are developing a wiki-based crowdsourcing platform for creating, integrating, and curating knowledge graph. Given that now we can use the Singleton property to integrate the tuples. So that should be submitted by January. And another work that we are so doing is the access control model. Given that now we can represent the statement using the Singleton property, we would be able to provide the access control at the triple level. And I am also working on evaluating the Singleton property approach in a larger scale. Given that we have interest from UniProt and PubChem, these two datasets are really big, and like UniProt is 15 billion of triples, and PubChem, I think it should be more. I just don't remember the number. And recently, I heard that there is a discussion going on in the RDF working group, W3C working group, about the Singleton property, and one of their main concerns is about the reasoning. If they are adopted, does it break the our reasoning or RDF's reasoning or not? So, so there is a community effort for comparing the approaches and make the recommendation on the on this kind of problems. It is still going on, and I don't know. Like I'm gonna be a part of that. Right now I don't have anything to report.
I think it's stupid to require to focus on our reasoning. Just forget about it and get something. Yes, our dear reasoning, yes. And not make that as a requirement, but some
Fun.
Guys want to, so.
Yeah. So because like it is not like it will break the reason. It is just like we did not address that one in our paper. And like as we provide the formal semantics, and I also explain the RDF, RDFS rules, how do we support it in that model. So I think it there's a potential for that work.
Yeah,
good
but
work.
Somebody will have to do a good bit of work.
Oh, I will, yeah. If I have time, then I will work on it. I don't know, depends. So these are the plan that I have for the work that I will be carrying out until I graduate. And I would like to thank the dissertation committee, Dr. Shed, the advisor who has been very patient and forgiving because I'm kind of weird. And Dr. Prasad, like I took all of his courses and like we have a lot of discussion. And Dr. Bodenreiter, are you there? I spent like two summers with him, and like we had a lot of interesting discussion that gave me the motivation as well as the material for my dissertation. And Dr. Kemofo Anianu. She's not nurses, right? But she's like nurses a legend and kind of like a role model for me. And second, I'm working on a material science team with Mr. Claire Parr, it's over there. And I really appreciate that he took my research and use it in his work, and he also like presented to the material science domain. Something that I really appreciate. And the material science team and the TQZ team, a lot of us, and the collaborators that I collaborated with, I did internship with. So I didn't put the name of like all of us here, but I just want to say that I really appreciate that I spent like 5.5 years now. I have grown up so much compared to like when I just came at Noesis. So I did learn a lot from you guys, and I hope that in the rest of, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years to my graduation, I don't know when yet. Until that time, I will be able to, like, I'm looking forward to more collaboration and like having more fun with you guys. So. You
learn more when you show up with all the social functions.
I'll try.